it's favorite, but these are Chris's. So I'm going to start out with some background. TFT here is topological field theory. Maybe I'll say one word at some point about why I didn't write a Q. But so the background I want to talk about is sort of a. I want to start out with kind of a broad philosophical point about something I want to call higher algebra. And here the key thing is we write algebraic formulas on a line. X times Y times Z. You can multiply the left, you can multiply the right. Why do we do that? Why do we write algebraic expressions on a line? We write algebraic expressions on a line because it all came out of language, right? We write words on a line. And so when we went from writing words to writing symbols, we wrote our symbols on a line.
Fair enough.
And, but there's really no mathematical reason when you're studying some algebraic structure that it makes the most sense on a line. There are tons and tons and tons of things in algebra where writing on a line is not the right thing to do. It's better to write on a plane and do planar algebra or write on higher dimensional manifolds. So let me say that and give some examples. This is for non-mathematical reasons. And often, other shapes are better. So I'm going to give a couple examples of this that are all sort of common, well-known things. The first of them, the classic example, is the trace of a matrix A, which should be written like this. So what does that mean? When you multiply two matrices, of course, what are you doing? You're just summing over some shared index. If you have a single matrix with an input and an output, and you just sum over shared indices, you get exactly the trace. So the trace should be drawn on a circle. Drawing on a line gives you entirely the wrong intuition for how traces work. It's better to draw on a circle. And as an example of why this is great notation, of course, the fundamental fact about traces is the fact that trace of AB equals trace of BA. And once you're in the correct setting where you draw this on a circle instead of on a line, it's obvious that trace of AB equals trace of BA because you just slide it around. Okay. A more interesting example. So this is going to be a standard thing from TQFTs and even earlier, going all the way back to the work of Schur in the early 1900s. If sigma is an orientable surface, and there's a version of this for non-orientable surfaces as well, which I won't write down, and weirdly enough, the non-orientable version goes back further than the orientable one. Then you get the following theorem, sum over V and Urep of dim V raised to the Euler characteristic of the surface is the size of the group raised to the Euler characteristic of the surface minus 1 times the number of homomorphisms from pi 1 of the surface to G. And this is a theorem, one for every surface, and so it ought to be that the proof involves doing some calculation on that surface. And in fact, as people probably already know, you could think of this as you are computing some invariant of a surface, and you do it in two different ways. And so each surface, you do a calculation on that surface, and you get a different theorem. And if your surface is the sphere, then this tells you the first theorem you learn about representations, that the sum of Dimby squared is the size of the group. So that's the first theorem you learn. And the second theorem you learn about characters is actually the one from the torus, which says that the number of irreps equals the number of conjugate classes. On this side, you certainly get the number of irreps because you're raising to the zero. And on this side, you're looking at Homs from Z cross Z to G. That's counting pairs of commuting elements, which is counting, it ends up counting conjugacy classes. You have to do a little calculation. Okay, so this is a second example of a theorem in algebra that's best done, in this case, by doing your calculations on a sphere or on a torus. Okay? And then the example that I want to talk... Yeah?
That's not the equation by the auger. Where did that goes to?
Right, so this counts the number of pairs of commuting elements, which you can think of as summing over the group and counting the size of the centralizer. Now you're taking size of centralizer divided by the size of the group. That's so you're taking
the number of elements
yeah.
in the compass.
Yeah, exactly. Sum over all the elements, one over the size of conjugacy class. So each conjugacy class gets weighted just once. There's lots of other fun things you can do for this, like what if G is an abelian group? That's a fun exercise. What does this tell you? Okay, so here's the example that I want to talk about towards the end of today's talk, so this won't necessarily make complete sense now, but I want to say it kind of fits into the same story of higher algebra where you prove some, you have some theorem about some algebraic thing, and once you understand the right topological setting to draw your argument, it becomes clearer, okay? So the, there's a theorem of Radford's about Hopf algebras that was generalized by Edinghoff, Mikšić, and Ostrich to tensor categories, which says basically the following. I'm not going to state it super precisely just yet. It says that taking four duals is kind of boring. Okay? For semi-simple things, it says taking four duals is actually boring. And for more general things, it gives you a formula for it, okay? So this is, you might think from vector spaces that taking two duals should get you back to where you started. And it actually turns out that for tensor categories, we don't know that. Taking two duals is extremely hard. This is why everyone is always saying words like spherical and pivotal, and why every talk, you know, a quarter of the way through gets interrupted with, are you assuming that's pivotal or spherical? And it's because double duals aren't boring. But it turns out that quadruple duals are boring, and you could ask, why is that? And the answer is because of the bell trick. You know, this thing that you all, physicists, of course, all probably know this very well, because that's where spinners come from. But the idea is going to be that pi 1 of SO3 loops in SO3 is Z mod 2, because of the double cover of SO3 by SU2. And it's going to turn out that in a precise sense, this double dual here corresponds to the generator of pi 1 of SO3. And so doing it once is something interesting, but doing it twice is boring, because this gets you back to where you started. Okay. So again, this is going to be a proof that makes the most sense once you think of the calculation as taking place on some higher dimensional thing, in this case, the beltboardism. So you think of that as some two-dimensional surface that starts out with some twisted, doubly twisted thing and then untwists it as it goes. Okay. So that's kind of one of the things I'm going to aim for in this talk, and I wanted to give in the background kind of how it fits in this general framework of doing higher algebra, doing algebraic calculations on higher dimensional things. Yes?
Did you experiment with the second example fit your UTL philosophy? This is not one-dimensional?
That's not one-dimensional. This is also not one-dimensional. It's two-dimensional.
That's not one different for a first grade reason, but if there's anything more than just because the two-dimensional surface is.
Yeah. So you're doing the calculation...
In where?
On... essentially, you calculate the value of a TFT on that surface in two different ways, and it gives you the two sides of that equation. Yeah, maybe it's a little bit different flavor than the other two. But, other questions? Yeah.
How do we know to use SO3 in your example? Lots of spaces in the same fundamental group.
Yeah. It'll come up in a very natural way. So, hold on to that question, and hopefully by the end it'll be answered. But, One other thing I want to say about this is, one might say, oh, this gives a new proof of Radford's theorems for tensor categories. That's actually not the case. It's better than that. It gives the old proof. So if you actually just take the surface and you just unfold what everything means, it recovers for you exactly the old proof. And so it actually explains not just the theorem, but the proof, which I think is really nice.
Radford's proof?
What?
Radford's proof?
No, your proof. All right.
Get used to it.
Okay. What else was I gonna say? Oh, yeah. All right. So that's that bit of background. Let me then move on to what local TFTs are. Right, so, of course, probably everyone here knows what a TQFT is, but let me just remind you of how mathematicians think about it. You've got your bunch of closed n-1 manifolds. If you have a closed n-1 manifold, it's supposed to be a vector space. If you have a n-manifold with boundary, one side of its boundary is one n-1 manifold, the other side is some other one, and so it sends it to a map between those vector spaces. It's a linear map. And there's several operations you can do on this. You could glue things. You could take your picture here and glue it to another picture there. That corresponds to one linear map and another linear map. And the corresponding thing you do over here is just compose the linear maps. And finally, you could take disjoint union, and this should be tensor product. Okay. This is a nice concrete thing, but to make it sound scarier, we give everything names. So this collection of things is a symmetric monoidal category. Let me pause to say what that is. It's a category because it has two levels of things. It has objects and morphisms. It's a tensor category because it has this disjoint union. Okay? And this over here is another, and it's symmetric because it doesn't matter which order you take disjoint unions in. This is also a symmetric monoidal category. It has things, maps between them. You can compose those maps. And it's symmetric monoidal because you can take tensor products, and tensor products of vector spaces don't care about the order. And this is just saying that it's a tensor functor of these things. Okay, so this is TQFTs. Now, TQFTs are great because you can think of them as a way of computing not tall enough for this blackboard. as a way of computing invariants of manifolds by cutting and pasting. So even if what you care about is just invariants of manifolds, TQFTs are better because they give you a more computable kind of invariant. So even if you just care about what happens to the closed n-manifolds, this says you can compute what they are just by chopping them up along a bunch of n-1 manifolds, calculating those, and gluing it all together. Okay? But this is only so good because if you have an n-manifold and you chop it along n-1 manifolds, the n-1 manifolds are still complicated. So if you were in one or two dimensions, maybe this would be good enough. But in higher dimensions, it gets pretty hard because surfaces are still kind of hard. Okay? So the idea of local TFTs, my understanding is this local is supposed to be reminiscent of how the word local is used in physics, but I don't make any guarantees that that's actually, anyway, you can decide whether that's helpful or not. But the idea of local TFTs is we have our N-manifold, we want to calculate this invariant to it, we cut it up along N-1 manifolds, the N-1 manifolds are still complicated, so we chop those up until in the end, everything has gotten boring. Okay. So the idea of local TFT is keep cutting deeper and deeper and deeper. Said that way, it doesn't sound very appealing, but all right. So what's the idea of that? Now, so let me say before I state this, there's sort of two points about this. One is that local TFTs are much easier than ordinary TFTs. Why are they much easier? And that's because in the end, there's only boring things. In the end, you get down to just points, and points are boring. Okay? So in some sense, you should think TFTs are much easier, local TFTs are much easier than ordinary TFTs. Okay? But as always, there's a price that you pay for making something easier, which is something else is going to get harder. They're harder. Why are they harder? Well, here we're assigning numbers to closed N-manifolds, right? It's assigning linear maps to ones with boundary. The closed N-manifold is just assigning a linear map from the trivial vector space to trivial vector space. That's just a scalar, so it's just a number. But in order to get it to fit into a TQFT, we have to start with numbers and replace them with a much more complicated world of vector spaces and linear maps. Okay, well, vector space and linear maps aren't so bad, but they're worse than numbers. And the same thing is going to happen in local TFT, that the further and further and further you want to be able to cut things, the more complicated your things you're assigning are going to be. Okay? So this is harder because the things assigned have lots of structure. And maybe not so surprising. If you want in the end to get down to things that are boring, somewhere that structure has to be there, and the structure kind of goes into just what kind of things you're assigning to lower dimensional pieces.
So this is
local or extended. Maybe we'll put this parentheses. The reason I'm not using extended is you could stop this process however you want. So TQFTs go down one level. You could go down two levels or three levels. Local means go all the way down to points. And extended could maybe mean anything in between. Okay.
What about dropping the Q? Does that have a meaning?
Yeah, I'll save that in 1 second. Right, so here the idea is we want to have, so we have our N manifolds, we cut them along N-1 manifolds, and we cut the N-1 manifolds along N-2 manifolds. If you start seeing how that whole thing gets cut up, you'll see that these start having to have corners. Okay, so in the end, what you end up with is you have 0 manifolds, which are just your points, you have 1 manifolds with boundary. You have your 2 manifolds with corners, dot, 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 down to N manifolds with corners. And here by corners, I mean sort of arbitrary codimension corners. You can still glue. Gluing is now quite a bit more complicated because you can kind of glue in all sorts of different dimensions, but I'm just going to call it gluing. And you still have disjoint union. Okay, What happened over here? Well, we figured out what was the kind of structure that this boredism category had. It was a symmetric monodal category. And then we looked at a map from that to some symmetric monodal category that we understand extremely well, vector spaces. So we have to do the same thing. We have to figure out what kind of a gadget is this. And then we have to pick some nicer kind of that exact same gadget. Okay. So the first thing you have to ask is what kind of structure does this have? Okay. And it now has more layers. It has these things, these things, these things, these things. It's more complicated. Categories only had two layers. This has n plus one layers. Okay. And so, well, what is this? This is just called a symmetric monoidal n category. It's an n category, but you think of these as the objects, these as maps between objects, these as maps between maps, all the way up to that many layers. It's again symmetric monoidal because there's a disjoint union, and disjoint union doesn't care in what order you do things. And now we get, I'm sort of curious at this point, who is more uncomfortable with symmetric monoidal n categories? The mathematicians or the physicists? I think it could go either way. Because the mathematicians are grumpy because they don't know what the definition is. But the definition is just, it is the kind of structure that this is, okay? And any answer you could give to, you just understand what is the structure that you can do with n-manifolds with corners, and that just is what it is to be a symmetric monoidal n category. Like, this example is sufficiently general that any concrete description you could give of the structure, the kinds of gluing you can do, would give you a definition of n category. Okay, so I'm not gonna try to tell you what a symmetric monoidal n category is for two reasons. One, it's extremely complicated, and two, I don't understand it. Fortunately, at least one of my co-authors does. Okay.
I thought that's a little more
specific.
What?
Maybe he doesn't ever try.
Excuse me. So,
yes.
Can we just take this pictorial definition? It should be okay. I mean,
yeah. An N category is something that has these, that has N plus one layers of structure, and which you can compose in the same way that you can compose N manifolds with corners. So, for example, you should be able to convince yourself with two manifolds with corners, you can kind of glue them along edges or along vertices, and you kind of get two different compositions. Okay.
Do you get any particular type of strictness for
this? No, weak. And in fact, I should make things even weaker than I did here. You could allow past N manifolds, you could allow diffeomorphisms of N manifolds and isotopies of those all the way down to infinity, and that would be even better. But weak. But that's true of this example. So again, if you have something that captures this example, you probably have something that's actually general enough to be a definition of n. Okay.
So maybe another thing, because if I triangulate the n-manifold,
yeah,
this is zero manifold like correspond to vertex or correspond to the n-manifold with color.
The zero manifolds are kind of like the vertices. Yeah. I mean, if you think of...
Oh, I see. So a manifold is called with like a face, some kind of face.
Yeah, I mean, maybe, the standard example I should give, like a saddle, and here we discover whether I'm a topologist or not. I have a saddle like that. That's a two-manifold with corners. So you think of this as a map from this to this, and where each of these are themselves one manifold with boundary, right? So here's your points, here's a one manifold with boundary, here's another one manifold with boundary, here's the disjoint union of them, so I've used tensor product here. Up here I have this one and this one, they're also disjoint unioned, and then this is a two It's a two-boardism with corners in between them. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, now we run into the hard thing and why I dropped the Q, which is, okay, we know what this arrow is going to be. It's going to be a symmetric monoidal n functor, right? A functor of symmetric monoidal n categories, whatever that means. But it's the correct notion. It means all of the things should match up. However, I glue on the left should match up with gluing on the right. But on the right, I have to put some other symmetric monoidal n category. And the problem is, everyone kind of agrees on what their favorite symmetric monoidal category is, vector spaces. Maybe not everyone, maybe some people would say it'd be better to just use sets, but vector spaces are great, everyone loves them. And the reason there's a Q, I'm told, is that quantum has to do with vector spaces, right? You can take superpositions of things. If I use sets here, or if I use symplectic, if I had like, you know, correspondences of manifolds or something, you could have various things that maybe they're not quantum, they're like classical field theories.
The real reason is the disjoint union to tensor product. That's,
exactly.
That's
yeah.
the reason for
yeah.
it.
Yeah. Yeah. And but still it's tensor product of vector spaces as opposed to, say, disjoint union of sets. You could put over here like sets, set maps, and disjoint union of sets or something like that. Is it disjoint union or product of sets? One of those two. Anyway.
No, even in vector space, you can replace tensor with direct sum. That's still a symmetric.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah. Yeah, but so the point is just that it's quantum because this is a quantum world with vector spaces and tensor products. Here, we don't know what to put on the right-hand side, and we can put, so basically what we do is we just generalize it. We say, put anything you want on the right-hand side. Okay. This can lead to some silly examples. There's the trivial TFT, where on the right-hand side is the boardism category, and this is the identity map.
But the vector space should have all this structure.
So it should still be symmetric monoidal n category. Exactly. It needs to have all of these structures. Okay.
It's hard to see how vector spaces have these columns.
Right. So you can't put vector spaces over here. You have to put something more complicated than vector spaces. Okay? And the example I'll be talking about in this talk, the thing that will go over here will be something related to tensor categories, which I'll talk about in a minute. But the point is, this is going to be something harder. Okay? And since we can't all agree on what our favorite thing is, that's why I dropped the Q. Anyway.
We'll drop the F.
Yeah. Just a topological theory. Okay.
Keep the Q. Still.
Keep the Q. All right. So let me give an example of this. So this is. I mean, you could also, without talking about local, you could replace vector spaces with some other target and talk about ordinary, non-extended TFTs with values in something other than vector spaces. There's some interesting examples of that, like if you put representations of GLN on the right-hand side or something like that. Okay, so I want to do an example, which is to understand one-dimensional TQFTs, which is the same as one-dimensional local TFTs in vect with values in vector spaces. So when you're in one dimension, there's no difference between being local and not being local. Okay? So this is kind of a standard calculation, but if you haven't seen this one, nothing else will make sense. So we want to think about what is it you need to do to write down a one-dimensional TQFT. Well, let's say it's oriented. So I need to write down what is the value of this. This is going to be some vector space. I'm going to have a point that is oriented like this. That's going to be some other vector space, W. I'm going to have a picture like this. And what is that? That's going to start. Now you have to decide whether you read up or down. I'm going to read up. This is some map that's V tensor W. The because it's a disjoint union of this and this, and then it maps to nothing at all at the top, which is the trivial vector space. You need another thing like this, which should be a map from 1 to W tensor V, and these should satisfy a condition, which is that the zigzag should be the same as that. This is what you need to do. You have to give me a vector space, another vector space, some pairing like this, some map like that. Okay. Now what you can show is the fact that these two things exist with the zigzag is exactly telling you, well, what it's telling you is that this gives a perfect pairing between V and W. Okay. If this pairing, if there were things in V that paired trivially with everything in W, then those elements in V would be killed in the zigzag, which would be a problem. Okay, so it's a good little exercise on linear algebra, that if you want a map like this and a map like this that satisfy this condition, what has to happen is that W is the dual of V. Okay, so it's forced to be V dual. I probably should have written my things in the opposite order. Well, anyway, it doesn't matter. This tensor product is symmetric. This is the evaluation where things in V dual eat things in V.
So I don't see what the difference is between the second, the third, and fourth pictures.
One of them, right. So I'm drawing my pictures reading up the page.
What does the page have to do with it?
So probably what I should do is mark each boundary point as either an incoming boundary point or an outgoing boundary point. So here this is in, and this is in, and here this is out, and this is out. This is already true in TQFT, so you just have to tell people which boundaries are incoming boundaries and which ones are outgoing boundaries so that you know how to compose them. Okay? So we have certain boundaries that are called incoming, certain that are called outgoing. It's a convenient convention to use location on the page to do that, but really you don't need it. So those are both in, and here they're both out. And here this one is in, and this one is out.
You start to assume manifolds are oriented now.
Yeah. I will relax that later on. So yeah, I'll say oriented here. Okay. So this tells you that V has to be dual to V. And now, actually, if you can work out that this then needs to be the map that sends 1 to the sum of E upper I tensor E lower I. But if you want that to be in your vector space, if you want this to make sense, if you want it to live in this tensor product, and you're not completing or doing things in Hilbert spaces or something, this tells you that the dimension of V is finite. Otherwise, this sum won't make sense. So in the end, what do you find out? You find out that to give a one-dimensional TQFT, you have to give an object, you have to give a vector space. It has to satisfy a property that it's finite dimensional. And then everything else is determined from that. Just knowing the value of this actually tells you what this is up to equivalence, tells you what this is, and furthermore, tells you what the circle is. You can make the circle by gluing together these two things, and if you work out what that is, this is the dimension of V, because you take this sum, and then you pair them, and you can just get the dimension of V. Which again explains why dim V has to be finite for this to make sense, because if that was infinite, and then I'm out of space, but I wanted to say one last thing here, which is that you can actually put defects into this whole picture. And if you did, so you could think of this as the strand is labeled with V, but this is labeled with some map from V to V. And if you go through, if you put that into this picture, then this will again become trace of A. It will look like that example that was the first example.
Actually, there's one
more
structure you didn't mention.
Yes.
There's the
metric classical reaction. Yep. That's related to this part where I didn't write diffeomorphisms and isotopy and blah, 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 blah. In this particular example, on the right-hand side, there's no higher maps. So in this particular case, if the target is vector spaces, the mapping class group action on the circle has to be trivial. But in, if you allow an infinity one category on the right-hand side instead of a...
I'm talking about the mapping class group of n points. It's a basic representation of the permutation.
Oh, yeah. But it's... No, V is not a representation of the permutation group. V to the tensor n is a
representation.
And that just is because it's a symmetric monodal category. Yeah. Any other questions?
Are you going to say at some point whether these manifolds are framed or not?
Yeah, that'll come up in a minute. I am almost to the end of the background part, which is great. So what I wanted to say was, some possible targets. So we already saw that in one dimension, a natural target is vector spaces, the category of vector spaces. In two dimensions, one very nice target is algebras, bimodules, and bimodule maps, or sometimes called intertwiners. This is the standard example of a symmetric monoidal two category. Okay, this is the example of a symmetric monoidal two category that you're most likely to have heard of. The objects are algebras. The one morphisms are bimodules. The way that you compose, so a bimodule, an AB bimodule is a map from A to B. The way that you compose those, since they're maps between algebras, you're supposed to be able to compose them. You compose them by taking tensor product over the common factor. And then there are maps between these maps given by maps of bimodules. Yes?
So this is the one dimension, two dimensional mass in the one dimensional dimension over there.
Exactly. So if you're
your zero manifold will be like a number.
Yeah, that's
so
right.
One manifold
yeah.
Zero.
Yeah, a zero category, which is just a set. Yeah. Maybe you have to worry about the symmetric monodal structure. Maybe it's like a commutative group or something. Yeah, so what would this mean? This means if you wanted to understand local 2D TFTs with values in this target, what you would assign to points is algebras. What you would assign to intervals, to one manifolds of boundary, or bimodules between those algebras. And what you would assign to surfaces would be maps of bimodules. Okay. So this one's hopefully not too bad. This is a common thing. We want to get to three dimensions. With that in mind, we're going to take that and we're going to bump it up a dimension. How are we going to do that? Well, algebras are kind of like tensor categories. So we're going to replace algebras by tensor categories. Bimodules, you've already heard about in the other talks, they're bimodule categories, which are closely related to subfactors. And then you can talk about maps of bimodule categories. These are something called bimodule functors. And I'm not going to talk a whole lot about what those are. And then there's a top layer of something called bimodule natural transformations. Okay. And the details of this is a little bit, you know, all of those concepts are kind of tricky. But the important thing is that by adding one categorical dimension here, by replacing algebras where you have numbers that you multiply with tensor categories where you have objects that you tensor and then maps between them, you've upped the dimension level by one everywhere. Okay? And this is the example that I'm going to talk about. Okay? Before I talk about that, I want to mention that there are some other targets you might want to think about. There's a three-dimensional one where the target is roughly conformal field theories, and then some kind of defects. Okay. And I don't know a whole lot about this, but there's a bunch of papers by Douglas and Henricus and one of the Tobies.
The four dimensions.
Oh, yeah, I'm going to do four dimensions second. Yes.
And the
first row just to make it kind of consistent. It'll be vectors, comma, max between vector
spaces.
Minimax.
Yep.
Okay, that was good.
Yep. Very good. Okay, and then in four dimensions, there are some natural choices. Well, maybe what I should put here is tensor two categories or something and do the same things, but there's maybe a more concrete thing is here you have braided tensor categories. And I'm not going to fill in exactly what I put there, this is very interesting. Freed and Telemann have some stuff that they're doing with that. There's also some Jordan and Bensby and Rochier have some interesting stuff that's also related to this. So there is interesting stuff in the next dimension as well. Yeah.
But should I put something in more general? I'm worried about a braided tensor category only have a particle. Obviously, you should also have a string. When you add a string, do you get something more general?
No. I mean, the braided tensor category includes the objects, which are the particles, and the morphisms between them, which are the strings, if I understand right.
So maybe the question is that these aren't the only or unique choices.
No.
So you could put something with strings and higher dimension stuff in this four dimensional slot if you wanted to.
That's right. These are not the only things. They're maybe not even the best ones. Kevin is fond of pointing out that this should be replaced with something more bimodulate, and he's right. But I'm not going to do that in this talk.
So this alternative version of three-dimensional.
Yeah.
What sort of CFTs?
Yeah, so the one that people are working on uses conformal nets. So there's a series of papers where there's
a two-dimensional CFT.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
For two-dimensional, why do you have three layers?
Because that's always the key. You have zero manifolds, one manifold, and two manifolds. The number of layers is always one bigger than n. Categories of objects and morphism. I mean, you don't want to talk. I mean, the when you're talking about the n-dimensional Bordism category goes up to dimension n. That means that including zero, it has n plus one dimensions between zero and n.
So in two dimension, the point would still be vector space.
No,
no,
it's a category
the
of
point
stations
is. The point is going to be the algebra.
So the
and the intervals are going to be bimodules for those algebras.
I see.
And the intertwiners are going to be what is assigned to surfaces with corners.
Actually, even in two dimensions, it's a different story. Like some people choose a category, some particular category of algebra. Right?
Yeah. Two dimensions, another great choice would be categories, functors, and natural transformations. These two are very closely related to each other. If you talked about nice categories, right exact functors, and natural transformations, then it's roughly the same thing as this anyway. But yes. Yep.
I apologize for asking. What's an algebra?
It's a ring. It's a ring that's also linear over a field.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Cool. Okay. So that's the end of kind of the setup of what local TFT is, and what we're working on is just trying to understand everything there is to say about this example. This is, to some extent, this is an example people have already thought about a lot. They're, Chiraya-Vero theories. Essentially, we haven't proved that they're Chiraya-Vero theories yet, but that's what they should be. So they're to some extent well understood, but this point of view both elucidates what's gone on before and sort of gives a few new things.
So this whether this structure is kind of a maximum or not, basically because on that side you have this manifold have a lot of structure. Whether these algebraics have enough structure which capture all the structure manifolds.
That's right. And maybe let me break back to the beginning. One of the points of view I'm taking is that my goal is to prove algebraic theorems, not theorems about topology. So from that point of view, it's fine that this doesn't have, and you also have to be a bit careful. You don't want to take things too far. The best thing to put on the right from the point of view of capturing all of the structure is the Bordism category and put the identity back. Then you don't lose any information at all. Okay? So there's a balance here. You want to lose some information to make things understandable, but you don't want to lose so much information that you can't see things. And one of the most interesting questions about tensor categories is very closely related to a big conjecture of ENOs is that is whether this is rich enough to understand spin. I'll come back to that later. Okay, so what I want to do is understand this, and in particular, I want to understand this in the service of proving theorems about tensor categories. Okay. So that's the first kind of three philosophies that you can think if you want to understand what's going on with our approach. The first one is that we want to use topology to understand tensor categories. A second philosophy that you might think of this is we're taking a category theoretic approach to tensor categories. Now, said this way, it sounds a little bit silly, so let me say what I mean by that. Tensor categories are categories. So in some sense, anything you do with them is doing category theory. But philosophically, category theory is a point of view. What category theory says is, okay, you have some object you're trying to study. Maybe it's some group. I have it here. It's in a box. Okay? There's a group inside there. Now, there are two ways you can study it. One, you can open the box and start pulling out the elements of the group and asking questions about what's inside the group. You can ask internal questions about your algebraic structure. The other thing you can do is ask external questions. You could ask, how does my group relate to other things? What maps does it have to other groups? What representations does it have? That would be maps GLV. What ways does it play with all of the other things? And for that, you don't necessarily even have to look at the elements. You just understand how it interacts with everything else. And that's the category theoretic point of view. Okay? And what this point of view is kind of similar to that. If you compare it to, say, Kevin's talk from this morning, where all of the pictures actually had the objects and the morphisms in them, our pictures are not going to have the inside of the category shown to you. All you're going to see is I have a point labeled with a category, an interval labeled with some bimodule. I don't label things with the actual objects in the categories or the arrows in the categories. So that's kind of a second philosophical thing. And maybe a third philosophical point of view is you can kind of think of, you know, one of many wildly oversimplified versions of history of tensor categories. You can think for a long time there were lots of pictures. If you look at, you know, Bakalov, Kirilov, there's tons and tons of pictures. And then if you look in ENO's work, there's no pictures and lots of bimodule category or module categories. This philosophy is now kind of ironic after I had to draw a picture in Dimitri's talk, but
No, what is NO?
So you don't call it
heading off Nikšić and Ostrich.
Okay.
Sorry. It's somewhat standard notation in the field now, but given that I'm talking about physics, I should say that. Not Brian,
They do have lots of diagrams. If we don't call diagram as a picture.
Oh yeah, they're like commutative diagrams. That's true. And so the idea of this is we can sort of put in pictures. In their world. So you have both some kind of pictures and the real importance of module categories and bimodule categories. And to some extent, that's kind of, I think it's kind of nice. It's sort of a remarkable the extent to which every time the pictures told us what theorem we needed, they'd already proved that theorem. Okay. But I think it's still nice to have the pictures involved in it. All right, any questions about that? That's all the what the story I want to tell is, where it comes from. Any questions about that? Yes?
Yes, I wonder whether in three dimensions, if one have this modular tensor category, that's the bigger structure than what you write down here.
Yeah, so that's a bit weird. When you're working with modular tensor categories, it's actually sort of naturally four-dimensional. It sort of lives down here. But the four-dimensional part of it is pretty boring, and so there's kind of a dimension reduction thing you can do to go from four down to three. And so it's a... Anyway. All right. Okay. So I said local TFTs should be easier. Why are local TFTs easier? Well, that is a theorem called the cobordism hypothesis. Which was originally conjectured by Baez and Dolan, and then sort of improved and proved by Hopkins and Lurie. Okay, and I'm going to state it in a minute. And, you know, this is much, I mean, I really like the stuff that we're working on, but the cobordism hypothesis is much more interesting. So if you stop me and ask lots of questions about this and I don't get to my stuff, that'll be okay, because this is something you should take home. So I'm not going to state it just yet, because I want to motivate where it comes from, all right? So what is the two-dimensional oriented bordism two category? So I'm looking at two manifolds with corners, one manifold with boundary and points, explicitly. I want like generators and relations. Okay. Which you can kind of do essentially with Morse theory. So what are the kinds of things you want to write down? Well, we already kind of understand what the pictures are for one manifold. So I'm going to be assigning something to a point. To this, I need to assign something that's kind of like a dual, and then these things, okay? So let's look a little bit about what happens in two dimensions. I'm going to unfortunately turn my pictures 90 degrees for no good reason. Here, these are both in. I have this thing, which, as we said, was some sort of evaluation on the point. Okay, I have the oriented point. This is some evaluation that takes the point and the opposite point and gives you back something in the trivial. Okay. And we also saw that if you look at this thing that forms a zigzag with it, so these should be out, this is co-evaluation. But there's other things you can do with these two things. So let me draw some of them. If I take a circle, there's a bordism by gluing in a disk that will take that to the empty picture. Okay. I can also, so this is something that relates a picture like this and a picture like this. Maybe you need to put in a little swap in order to make the orientations match up. But basically this circle is made out of these two pieces, but it has this extra structure of you can glue in a disk and get to the empty. You can also do the following. I could turn this into this by using a saddle. I'm not going to draw the saddle again. I remember the saddle on one side had a picture like this, on the other side had a picture like this. And the saddle gives you a bordism between these. Okay? And these two things are not unrelated to each other. There's a picture you can make out of them that looks like this. on the bottom half of this picture is a saddle. On the top here is the disc filling in the circle. And this is the same thing as just having a sheet here that does nothing.
So you ask, you know, now you're reading from bottom to top.
Yeah. I should be labeling ins and outs in lots of places, and I should label the bottom boundary, like, I should label this whole bottom boundary as in, and this as out, and then I should also tell you that these boundaries are out boundaries for this guy. And, yeah. But let me just not do all that labeling. And here is the crazy thing. This is just a Morse cancellation move. It's familiar in topology. Crazy thing is structurally, it looks exactly like that zigzag we already did. Over here, I have do nothing on the first factor and do a saddle on the second half, and then do this do this disc on the first half and nothing on the second half. And then here I have do nothing. This looks structurally exactly like the zigzag. This is a zigzag. That is, it looks formally exactly like this relation. Okay? And here is where one then needs to know a little bit of category theory. One of the most important ingredients in category theory is things that satisfy this kind of zigzag. And they're called adjoints to each other. There's a notion of adjoint functor. Adjoint functors are exactly the things that satisfy this kind of zigzags. And category theorists think about it a lot, and there's a great well-developed theory. And just like in the first case, where V determined its dual, knowing that it had a zigzag, it's also true that if you know something, it determines its adjoint in an essentially unique way. So that tells you that the fact that these two things satisfy these two relations tell you this, and the one the other way, are adjoint. I should be more careful. There are two notions, one of left adjoint and one of right adjoint. This picture shows one of them, and there's a corresponding picture where the maps went the other way that will show the other one. So in fact, they're both left adjoints and right adjoints to each other. Right, adjoint functors, adjoints are things F and G where F composed G composed F they are just, like, adjoints are just two things that when you compose them one way have a evaluation map to something trivial, and when you compose them the other way have a co-evaluation map that satisfies a zigzag. So you can think of, notice the empty is exactly the identity on nothing, and this is exactly the identity on 2 points, okay?
Why don't you say something about forgetful functor?
The standard example of adjoints is when you have a group, and you have forgetful functor that turns it into a set, and the adjoint functor going the other way is the free construction that takes a set and makes the free group on it. And if you think those two things aren't quite inverses to each other, you take a group, you forget the structure, and then take the free group, what you get is not the group you started with, but it has a canonical map to the group you started with. And in the other way, if you take a set, take the free group, and then forget back to the set, you've just made your set much bigger, but there's again a canonical map from the original set to the thing you made out of it. Okay? And all of those have this exact same structure of an evaluation and co-evaluation that satisfies zigzag. It's sort of super ubiquitous, but it's interesting that it comes up in topology as well as in really formal settings like free and forgetful functors. Okay? Anytime you have something is called free, it's because there's adjoint functors that are free and forgetful. Right. So what is the point of all of this? The point of all of this is that oriented two-dimensional Bordisms, all objects have duals. The positively oriented point has a dual, the negatively oriented point. And all one morphisms have adjoints. And these together, well, if I keep going as far as I'm allowed to go, which in this case is just two levels, this is called fully dualizable. Okay? So it says the Bordism category has a property, it's fully dualizable. Okay? But it doesn't just have these, it also has relations. And what kind of relations? Well, the co-evaluation may be composed with swap so that everything matches up. The co-evaluation has to be the same thing as the left adjoint of evaluation and has to be the same thing as the right adjoint of left evaluation. Because we saw that that other interval, on the one hand, forms a zigzag with evaluation, so it has to be co-evaluation. On the other hand, forms this two-dimensional zigzag with it, so it has to be the left adjoint. On the other hand, it also has to be the right adjoint. So that's complicated. It's hard to understand functors out of things that have relations because you have to check the relations. Right? If you want to understand a map out of something with relations, you have to check the relation. So this is hard. What we would like to do is have an easier category where all three of these things are different from each other. And here's the amazing theorem. The framed Bordism category, so framing here means you trivialize the tangent bundle, essentially. Framed Bordism category is the free, fully dualizable symmetric monoidal. It has no relations. Why is that? If you end up working through how things work, you'll find out that as framed intervals, these three things are different from each other. Okay? A framed interval in two dimensions corresponds to an element of pi 1 of SO2. SO2 is the possible framings on a point. And so framings on the interval are things in pi 1 of SO2. And these three intervals, this one, the one that satisfies this, and the one that satisfies the other thing, actually correspond to the elements 0, 1, and minus 1 in that pi 1 of the circle, which is z. They're all three different from each other. So that relation goes away once you put the frame setting. Okay? Any questions about that? So this tells you frame TFTs are easier. Okay. So that's something that you can take from all of this, is that if you want to understand TFTs, oriented ones are really natural, but framed ones are easier. Okay? So, yeah.
I understand what's different between a frame and a non-frame. We know that we'll give a three manifold, you'll get a number. Three closed manifold give you a number.
So now it's going to depend on the framing. You have to fix a framing of your closed three manifold, and it will still give you a number, but the number will depend on the framing.
I see.
Yep.
But no, then for that, for no framing, you just put them away.
What?
If you have no framing, then
you don't get anything for that manifold. So let me end by stating some of our results about this. I wanted to give some you've seen a bunch of talks about what tensor categories are.
Questions.
But I only have 2 minutes, right? Is that true?
It's 4 minutes.
Okay, yeah.
Is the thing you wrote there labeled theorem?
Yes, this is the Bordism hypothesis. And what it says is that to give a map, to give a framed local TFT is just to know the value of a point. Because there are no relations, what it tells you is all you have to do is pick a possible point. You have to pick a point that satisfies this property of being fully realizable. And once you've done that, the rest of the theory is completely determined for you. Okay? So that tells you, if you pick a fully dualizable tensor category, this theorem just produces out of that an entire local TFT. Okay. So here are our theorems. The dual of some tensor category C is C with the opposite tensor product. Maybe I'll write that this way. No, that's terrible. Tensor opposite. You take the same tensor category but with the opposite multiplication. And this zigzag, this thing, is just C as a C tensor C opposite module. Okay?
Both sides do the same.
Yeah, both, like, in order to turn a right action into a left action, you have to put in a switching the direction of tensor product, but otherwise it's just boring. And this always works, basically. You don't need any assumptions. Then you might ask, what about for one-morphisms? And here, if you have a bimodule, you have M as a CD bimodule, I want to build the other interval that it will form saddles with. And the answer is, you look at functors from M to C. And this is now a DC bimodule, where this acts here, this acts here. You have a residual action by D here and by C here. So this tells you that this thing hasn't, so this is the adjoint. One of left and right for the other one interchange the roles of C and D. This uses rigidity in a strong way. And then, because we're in three dimensions, we also care about whether functors of bimodule categories have adjoints. And there are two theorems. In the finite semi-simple setting, module functors automatically have adjoints. The formula is pretty straightforward. It's just taking a transpose of a matrix. And there's another theorem, and this uses the EO exact module categories theory. If you just assume finite, you still get almost all the adjoints you need. So you don't get a full three-dimensional theory of applied to finite tensor categories, but it's fine on points, it's fine on one manifold, it's fine on two manifolds, and it's actually fine on most three manifolds, but not the closed ones. Okay. And just to bring things back to what I said at the beginning, you can look at a framed interval, so I'm going to put a twist in it so you can keep track of the fact that this is not the usual framing of the interval, it's one with a twist. If you ask, what does the TQFT do to this, it will send it to C as a CC bimodule, but where this action is twisted by the double dual. So the kind of applications we have in mind for this is this kind of a thing. Kind of the goal is to understand all the technical things that have been confusing us in tensor categories. So stuff like, why is it that quadruple duals are easy, but the triviality of double duals is a huge hard open problem? Well, it's because the triviality of quadruple duals is telling you that pi 1 of SO3 is Z mod 2, because there are only two different three framings on an interval. So that tells you that. Why do people talk about spherical and pivotal? Where do those all come from? Well, one of them comes from if you look at things that are invariant under all changes of framing, under the SO3 action, and the other one comes from invariants just under an SO2 action. So that tells you why are spherical and pivotal there. Why is it that spherical things are talked about a bunch? Well, an arbitrary fusion category gives you a framed TQFT. A pivotal one gives you one that depends on a combing, on a choice of non-vanishing vector field. A spherical one gives you one that only depends on an orientation. Okay? So all of these annoying adjectives on the algebra side correspond to non-annoying adjectives on the topology side. And that's it.
Question. How does your result about a point compares to an extraordinary cohomology series, which are also defined by one point value?
That's a good question. It may be that you can. I want to say that that stuff makes sense in the setting of invertible field theories and infinite Fordism categories. So you could send n to infinity, and you could ask about values there, and it'll actually turn out they have to satisfy a much stronger condition than dualizability. They actually have to be invertible, and then invertible field theories are